Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Black Heart Fades Blue, Volume 2, by Jerry A. Lang, read by David DeVries. 1. On tour, there are more ways for things to go wrong than for things to go right. We proved this many times. We played a big show in L.A. opening for a band from England, GBH. Don't ever be fooled by the punk DIY tag. This was still the music business, just on a lesser scale. They still had all the scummy trappings of Led Zeppelin, just on a way smaller level. Chris Tenz hated the rock and roll side of all of this, and when we played in L.A., he let his inner germs side come out. If he could have gotten away with hitting one note all night, he would have done that. Instead, it was the old tried-and-true spitting, sneering, heckling, and insulting the crowd routine. And Tenz could heckle. We ended the show with me throwing a glass beer pitcher at the crowd and then jumping into a sea of bodies to start fighting. I remember getting a few good punches in before being knocked to the ground and then lying there thinking that I'd made a mistake. But I was again soon using the measuring tool of my father's fist and thinking, this isn't that bad, as I was getting stomped by a pack of boots with chains and bandanas tied around them. Luckily for me, Golden Voice Promotions hired giant security guys at their shows, and within a couple seconds I had this guy named Tiny, why are huge guys always named Tiny, sorting out the mob with me. He grabbed me by the neck with one hand and brought me to my feet and through the crowd. Safe. When we got back to Portland, the rock element in the band didn't appreciate the punk humor, and Tenz was once again asked to leave. That started a musical chair rotation of who's who, and we would bring different guys in and replace them the next month. For a short time, we had three-fourths of S. Hippie's old band as backup in Poison Idea. Then one guy was thrown out, another longer-haired guy came in. These people were all nice enough guys, they just came from a totally different world than Tom and I. The newest guitar player went on another tour with us and didn't really enjoy our negative camaraderie. Unless you're completely engulfed in the chaos and alcohol, you could really see the cracks in the negativity, and the humor can only mask so much. Sitting in the opening band's house in Salt Lake City with a combination of all the drugs I can think of, gallons of alcohol, and between the extreme European fetish films and a tape loop of a disgraced politician committing public suicide, it got old fast for the new guitarist. That was his breaking point. He quit the band on the ride back home. I swear when I slammed the van door shut and his hand got caught, that was an accident. I could see how someone might think that was a going away fuck you, but even I'm not that calculating. When he stepped down, P.I. had just started recording tracks that would become our third album, Feel the Darkness. We also had started booking our first tour of the East Coast of the U.S. Now, by this time, the band had been together for a few years. Groups from around the world would tour and come through Portland over and over. They were road warriors, but we were just getting out to the East Coast for the first time. We all had our safe bubbles of drunken security in Portland. Some of us were in our 20s and still living with our parents. Tom was selling cocaine with a steady clientele and making enough money to keep him going. We had become a sheltered, coddled, and very dysfunctional band. When the last guitarist quit, we were on tour in Salt Lake City. We called the house of the guy we had stayed with in SLC and asked if he would want to move to Portland, play guitar with Poison Idea, and live in a tent in Tom's backyard. Who wouldn't want that? So for the first East Coast tour, we recruited our latest guitarist, Aldine Strychnine from SLC. Also in the band at this time was our newest bass player, Myrtle Tickner. His real name was Charlie. Tom and I had a thing about giving band members new names and encouraging them to reinvent themselves once they were in the band, a little like the family. Myrtle Tickner is a really good bass player. He had played in a band called the Oily Bloodmen, and I'd see him around town and make small talk. He was a smart guy, and I think he had studied philosophy in college. Charlie, as he was then known, was a long-distance runner, and when I was living at Glenn's house, I'd see him jogging by, even though he lived a few neighborhoods away. This guy was serious about running. One night, Glenn's family was away and I had the whole place to myself, so I invited some people over. We were drinking and listening to music. I spotted Charlie jogging by and shouted out to him. He came over and had a few drinks. I'd just gotten the Pogues' first album on import and was playing it. I hadn't realized that Charlie was something like 100% Irish, but here he was listening to the Pogues while drinking Guinness. I thought all of those songs were originals, but I later learned that some were Irish standards, almost lullabies, like Mary Had a Little Lamb would be to me. And Charlie just seemed really happy and at ease. I can't remember if his band broke up or if we nicked him, but it wasn't too long before he answered the call and was the new bass player in PI. He was a bad drunk, but a good guy. He became great friends with Tom. He loved the band, the music, the attitude, the atmosphere, and our shtick. He lived the life. Booze was his demon. There's a picture of him with a battered face and a broken tooth. That came about because he got drunk one night and went through the food bins at Safeway. The security guard discovered him, then beat and kicked the shit out of him. He broke his tooth and ripped his eyelid. When Charlie joined up, Tom rechristened him Myrtle Tickner. I have no idea where the name came from. Tom just loved unusual-sounding juxtapositions. Tom liked playing around with names. He once had a ham radio and created some funny monikers. One crazy handle he used was Baby Laxative. The very name set some people off. One listener, a long-haul trucker, got so outraged by the name that he threatened to beat Tom up. Of course, Tom hammed it up like he was the most twisted pervert and egged on the irate trucker and challenged him to meet on the roadside in an isolated location and have it out. He really strung that trucker along. He played him like a fiddle. The guy was so riled up, it was easy to imagine him driving way out of his way and showing up in the middle of nowhere for a showdown that would never take place. Tom named himself Pig Champion. He had been Tom Pig when he was in the Imperialist Pigs, but he wanted something new. He tried to think of something opposite from Pig, and he came up with Champion. That would do it. He liked the sound and juxtaposition. I remember a young guy called Tom a pig once. He hurled it like a vicious insult. He meant it in the most disparaging and demeaning way, implying that Tom was a fat slob. This kid was nicknamed Skunk. He wore a leather jacket with the word skunk written on the back. He had a mohawk with an orange streak down the middle. I remember Tom shouting back, "I'm not a pig, skunk." That comeback always makes me laugh. My world. Mondo was a bit of a mystery. He came to us from a heavy metal band and he had chops. He could recreate any bass or guitar sound. He was never a punk guy, but he could mimic any sound he heard. I guess some savants are like that. When you meet someone you're considering playing music with, it's common to check out their record collection to look for common ground and for recommendations. But there was almost nothing to check out. He had a few old Italian records, maybe some doo-wop, and a few rock records everyone would know. What amazed me about Mondo was that he could hear a song once or twice and he could reproduce it perfectly. It could be a song by King Crimson, Hawkwind, Thin Lizzy, Gizm, a Uli John Roth solo, whatever you can think of. No matter how technical or adventurous, with only one or two listenings, he could knock it off effortlessly. S. Hippie was someone you would like a lot one minute and dislike the next. He could be really charming one moment and a spoiled brat, a mama's boy, the next. Once he got caught stealing box sets from one record shop and trying to sell them to another. Since the shop owners liked him, they didn't call the cops. They just temporarily banned him. But he wouldn't make amends. He wouldn't apologize, even when he was caught red-handed. Instead, he went back to one of the stores and threw a cinder block through a big glass window. Some people saw him as a real charmer. Others saw him as a crybaby. He could make friends really quickly, and he could be the life of the party, a real fun guy. On the other hand, I got a report from a friend he had stayed with once. The night before Hippie left, my friend noticed that Hippie had set aside some rare singles by the Damned. And after he was gone the next morning, so too were those records. If something went wrong, he'd just cry and everyone would give him another chance. You had to be careful. He'd throw anybody under a bus. But like I've said, he could be charming, and he was one hell of a drummer. I heard that Duke Ellington once said something like, "If you've got a good drummer, you've got a good band." I've always said that a band is only as good as its drummer and is only as strong as its weakest link. Chris Tense didn't like the new direction of Poison Idea once we started getting the rock guys in the band. Chris was into old-school California punk. He hated when hardcore moved toward the crossover sounds of bands like DRI, Metallica, and Slayer. It was in fashion at this time for punk bands to think that they could actually become popular and accepted by the mainstream, and bands were doing all the stuff they had to do to try and make that a reality. The major American bands that were touring nonstop and putting out product, that old tested cycle, meet the new boss, same as the old boss, well, some of those band members did parlay that into a career they carried forward into the next couple of decades. But a lot of wannabes were signing to major labels, growing their hair long and making shitty music to back up their laughable images. Caricatures, chasing trends. It was ripe for parody and would make a good mockumentary. Delusions of grandeur. In the haze of crack smoke and self-fellatio, Poison Idea thought we might become somewhat popular also. That was never going to happen. There was a roots-slash-rockabilly band in Portland that had a manager named David who was getting things done for them. I would see him every weekend at Satyricon. He was also a photographer, and I think we originally approached him to do photos for the band. But once he got comfortable with us, we asked if he would like to take us on and be our manager. There was a lot to do. We were busier than shit. We figured he could help with our mail order, handle press releases, oversee our bank account, assist with driving, and take care of whatever else would arise. He was up for it. He worked a full-time job, but he came from an entertainment background and now was trying out his hand in band management. David had an interesting backstory. His father, Honey, played the Grand Ole Opry for many years and had known Hank Williams, Ernest Tubb, and other country legends. He was a performer but was more of a comedian than a musician. Comedy came first. His father would likely be better known today, but he had been a minstrel, which many now regard as an embarrassment that should be swept under the rug and quickly forgotten. Even Emmett Miller, the most famous minstrel who influenced many country legends, is now largely forgotten. But David came from a Nashville world where a who's who of country superstars would hang out at his house. Hank Williams would come around to tell his troubles to David's mom and seek her advice. Flat and Scruggs were among the many regulars, and so was Roy Acuff, who was David's godfather. So along with our new members Myrtle and Aldine, we now had a new manager to book our East Coast tour, David Wilds. We never gave him a wacky stage name. Tom used to call him YY, but he didn't seem to take to that name. He was listed as Wildman on one of our records, probably in reference to Wildman Steve, the old Chitlin Circuit comedian. I don't think David was ever a real fan of our music, but he liked the energy and excitement of our shows, and he liked that we could draw a big crowd. Maybe he liked being part of something bigger than himself. He definitely enjoyed the camaraderie. His father once had a traveling tent show of Grand Ole Opry entertainers, so David grew up watching his old man bailing people out of jail and doing whatever was necessary to keep the show on the road. His father sometimes carried a pistol, and usually carried a sharpened pocket knife and a large crescent wrench, a common work tool that could double as a weapon. One interesting tidbit is that Colonel Tom Parker, who would go on to manage Elvis, worked as an advance man for the tent show. He was a factotum for Honey Wilds, and the two were friends. When it came to promoting Elvis, Colonel Tom even asked if Honey wanted in on the action, but he failed to see the king's appeal and passed on his chance to become a millionaire. David was a real Southern gentleman, but he really had his job cut out for him babysitting these lunatics on this tour. We all had fun times, but looking back, I feel kind of bad we put him through the ringer. I mean, just for starters, there were the drugs, which he did not participate in. If he walked into a room and someone pulled out a syringe, he would turn on his heels and walk right out the door without saying a word. He never said he was insulted, embarrassed, or what he thought about it. he would just leave. Then he had to clean up all our messes. There would be many as we went along. P.I. played a show in Washington State once, I think maybe in Bremerton, where a guy was lying on the stage looking up at me. People got a good laugh out of that. I thought it was funny myself for half a song, but it grew tiring, so I asked the guy to get up. He said, "No, man, I'm tripping on acid." I kicked him lightly. "Dude, you gotta get up." He said, "No, man, I can't. I'm frying. I'm so high." I said, "Get up now or I'll piss in your face." He didn't budge. So I unzipped my pants and emptied my bladder. Let me tell you, he wasted no time jumping up. I remember thinking there were some scat lovers in Germany who would have paid good money to be humiliated on stage by my golden showers. You kind of learn stagecraft by doing it. I had a few tricks besides pissing on people. I could kick a mic stand and have it come right back to my hand. I could usually do this even if I was hammered. There was a time I roped in a guy with the mic cord and choked him. I didn't make a habit of using my microphone as a lasso, it just happened in the moment. It did take a long time for me to learn how to protect my voice. I'd come back from a long tour hoarse for weeks or spitting out blood. I did damage to my vocal cords from all the shouting. I had a sore throat from screaming from the stage and not singing with my diaphragm. I'd give myself a break sometimes by putting the microphone into the audience and letting the crowd sing the chorus. It was a small act of self-preservation that might enable me to make it to the next gig without blowing out my voice. Another trick, if you look into the middle of the crowd and point, many people in the audience may think you are communicating directly to them. If you see a big act do this, thousands of people in the audience may think the performer is connecting to them personally, when really the musician might just be going through the motions while considering what they've got to eat backstage. Strange moments happen that you can't envision. Once I was in the middle of a show and in walks a girl wearing what looks to be a Chanel dress, maybe with polka dots and a pillbox hat. It was my sister. I hadn't seen her in a long time, and she was not someone who was coming to my gigs. I was excited she was there. It was almost an honor, and I kept pointing to her and the guy she was with, her new boyfriend, as if to say, "What are you doing here?" As soon as the show ended, I jumped off stage and ran to the back of the room, making a beeline right for her. When I got within 10 feet, I realized it wasn't my sister. It was a total stranger. Do you ever have a moment when you think someone is waving at you and you respond only to learn that they were motioning to a person behind you? What do you do? In this case of mistaken identity, I continued on to the couple and said, "It's cool that you came. Did you like the show?" They were probably perplexed why I had singled them out. The girl said, "Yeah, it was great." I said, "Thanks, I'm really glad you liked it. That means a lot." Then I turned on my heels and hurried off, maybe in time to ingest more drugs backstage. We played almost every night on this tour, driving for hours to a different state to set up, get drunk, play, then drive off, and do the same thing the next day. Rinse and repeat. Until we hit Cleveland, where we pulled up to the hall that some kids rented. They'd brought in a PA and went to the trouble of putting on their own brand of a Babes in Arms show. We all walked in, and I went straight to the bar and asked for a beer. The guy says all they have is Coors Light, and it's $3. I said I was in the band. He said, $3. So I turned around, walked back to the van, and said, "We're not playing. Let's go to a hotel and get drunk." David couldn't believe it. He said he'd buy me a six-pack, but I said I didn't feel right about this haul. Tom backed up my call and said, "Let's go." We all jumped back in the van, and the promoter came running out screaming as we drove off. David had to clean that up and make up some lie about why we left. The promoters never believed us, though. Off to the next city. Occasionally, there might be a rivalry with a band. A death metal band had some negative things to say about us in an interview. Not long afterward, we found ourselves playing the same clubs. They were trailing us by a few days, so Tom got inspired. He left graffiti on the walls of a club saying things like, "This band sucks shit through a straw." He probably started thinking about it in the van between shows and coming up with funny insults. So at the next club, the insults were even more cutting. Word got back to us that it had quickly started getting to this band and they became unglued. Tom was loving it, and we all had a good laugh about it. It was good to be in the Midwest, since we had followed some of those scenes from afar. We played shows with the Indianapolis band Sloppy Seconds. They were catchy and had a talented guitar player who was Tom's size. Indianapolis was cool because we had been reading about and listening to local bands like the Zero Boys for years. Lots of important bands came out of Michigan. I suppose that had been true for decades, what with Motown and all the Detroit hard rock from the 60s and 70s. Of the newer bands, Negative Approach was a standout, definitely one of the most influential hardcore bands ever. One cool thing that happened was the wife of one of the guys in MC5 came and checked us out. She seemed to know, or at least appreciate, our music, and I could imagine her playing it for her husband. Some bands might talk about some big movie starlet coming to see them. This meant more to me. Tom had been obsessed with The Fix from Lansing, Michigan. It was a group that only put out a couple of singles on Touch and Go in the early 80s. It was blistering hardcore that wowed Tom. As I mentioned earlier, we went to see them once, but the show got canceled. The band never showed up. It was at a biker bar, and we may have been the only non-regulars who turned up. We were bummed when we were told there would be no show. Somehow Tom got inspired to contact the clubs that the band had played on that tour and ask if they had gotten promo kits along with the single. Many had, and Tom convinced them to sell them for a few bucks. The clubs probably would have thrown them in the trash eventually, so they were happy to get anything they could. Tom tracked down a few copies that way. He also called a few college radio stations in the Midwest to see if they had any copies collecting dust. If they had copies of Vengeance and Jan's Room in their archives that were no longer being played, a station might just give it to him. As a result of his efforts, Tom managed to get between 5 to 10 copies of each single. What makes this notable is that both these singles were released in small quantities and would later become among the most sought-after punk records. Vengeance came out in an edition of 200, and Tom wound up getting 6 or 7 of them. He looked for that record because he loved it, and it meant so much to him. Now it looks like a savvy business move, since copies sell in the thousands. As I'm writing this, I learned a near-mint copy recently sold for $10,000. On the ride from Ann Arbor, we took a wrong turn off and ended up in some sketchy part of Detroit. We drove up to a car that was on fire and burning on the side of the road. People saw us and started coming toward our van, probably checking out what in the hell is this van full of fools doing here. As David was backing up as fast as he could, I reached out of my window and bashed on the side of his door 3 times as hard as I could. Thinking some local was pounding on his driver's side door, David damn near shot out of his skin. I could feel his heart skip. Everyone in the van laughed out loud, except David, who looked at me like he wanted to take a big justified swing at me. When we got to the hotel, he booked his own room and said he wanted to be left alone until the next morning. He had had enough of us for one day. We all agreed. When he went to his room, I gave it about 10 minutes and then had the front desk hook me up to his extension. When he answered, I spoke in my best, heavily accented Midwestern desk clerk voice. "Hi, you just pulled up and rented the 3 rooms. I think your van is on fire." We heard the phone drop and the sound of his feet running through the parking lot toward the van. When he saw us standing in the doorway, all laughing, once again, he gave us a look like we should be happy he wasn't holding a butcher's knife in his hands. But the thing was, we didn't single any one person out and turn up the heat. We did this to each other, hence the high turnover rate in band members. On a tour before this, I came to the conclusion that I had sleep apnea, since I was constantly blacking out and only keeping fully awake maybe 4 hours a day. Sleep apnea is a strange thing for people to understand. It's like you're both sleeping all the time yet never getting any sleep. You're rarely fully awake, but rarely do you get a deep, sound sleep. The first signs of sleep apnea occurred when I was working as a dishwasher in a Mexican restaurant. I'd go to the bathroom and fall asleep on the toilet. There were times I'd fall asleep standing up. One problem with not getting enough sleep is that it can make you hallucinate. I was rarely making it to the REM stage of the sleep cycle. When you can't get enough quality sleep, it can start to feel like you're losing your mind. There was one night when I woke up suddenly and walked over to a Sid Vicious poster I had on the wall. I might have had a pretty interesting conversation with Simon John Ritchie, or Simon Ferocious, as Freddie Mercury once called him, but I'll never know. It's no fun being on tour when you're exhausted from lack of sleep. I would lay in the top bunk above the driver's seat in our rented Winnebago, and the band members would count how long I would choke between breaths as I tried to sleep. They made a game out of this. No one was spared. The band, the audience, the public. God, the hotel rooms. 2. Tom was not built for touring, though he hadn't completely hit the wall yet where he absolutely could not travel. That comes later, but for now, bouncing around in the back of this van for days and days created a giant boil-slash-blood-blister somewhere in his nether regions. I never saw the exact location, though I sure heard enough about it. When we got to the hotel, he decided to cut it open to relieve the pressure. Earlier, one of us had thrown up all over the same hotel room. I did see the cups of blood, along with the pus and the vomit. We covered it all up with newspapers and sheets strategically placed, trying to hide it all. In the meantime, we repaired the hose on our van's engine, wanting to get away as soon as we could make our escape. It looked like a slaughterhouse. And that's why I say, God, the hotel rooms. We were on the road during our Beast Goes East tour when Tom heard from Sub Pop Records. They wanted us to do a single of the month club record for the label. Word got to us when we were in the Midwest. One of my bandmates had a song that we had kicked around, and Tom thought it might work if we fleshed it out. I said, "It's a decent song, but I don't think it's a single." Tom said, "So do you think you could do better?" He kind of threw down the gauntlet, to which I responded, "Well, yeah, maybe." So I grabbed a guitar and went to my hotel room in Chicago, and I started thinking to myself, what would a Sub Pop single sound like? It came to me in a hurry. To me, it was a pop song and pretty much wrote itself. If you ever hear it and it sounds like a simple pop song that was thrown together in 20 minutes, now you know why. The next day I played it for Tom and he liked it a lot. "I guess you did write a better song. Good job." And that's how Taken by Surprise was written. In Toronto, we played a show that was packed full. I had to keep using my body to push the crowd back off of the stage, pushing and pushing. As I kept at it, I felt a sharp shock in my lower left leg. When I pulled back from the crowd, I saw a 2-inch piece of glass sticking out of my leg. I reached down and started to pull it out, and another 1 to 2 inches were stuck in my leg. Either I fell perfectly on this long shard of glass or someone stuck me in the leg. It took just a flash, just a couple of painfully sharp seconds, and then like a cork being popped, the blood started shooting out. I tied it off with a dirty sock or whatever I could find until I made it back to the States and into a hospital. They gave me antibiotics and put a wrap on it. They told me to change the wrap daily, but I thought as long as it was wrapped professionally, it would be good. So I left it on, which plugged the hole and backed up the drain. I couldn't place any weight on it, and it fucking hurt so bad. My leg started turning black, and it got more swollen. Finally, the band had to make a space for me to lay flat on the floor in the back of the van as we soldiered on to the next town. We had a couple of shows left, and I could stand on crutches or sit in a chair. Leaving Denver and driving toward Portland, the pain had gotten so bad I thought I was going to pass out. I never saw my leg so swollen before. It looked like I had a water balloon the color of an eggplant growing out of my leg. I felt like the Elephant Man. Aldine had the seat in front of me, and he turned around to see how I was doing, and I went to move, then pop. Suddenly, there was a mixture of infection and blood that exploded everywhere. The hole became unplugged, and the big purplish-red flesh balloon popped, painting the inside of the van, even running down Aldine's face. At first he was puzzled. What the fuck is that? Taco sauce? When he realized it was a pus piñata, he freaked. You dirty bastard! The pressure had been relieved, though. Depending on which way I stand now, I either have a little dent or a bump that pops out of that hole. It took a little while to be able to walk on it again, but time healed those wounds. Now we were heading back to Portland, where we had to finish recording our album, Feel the Darkness. 3. Poison Idea has put out a lot of records over the years. I lose track of the bootlegs, outtakes, live shows, all the assorted crap that's been put out on vinyl or CD. These days, a record will get reissued, or someone in Spain will put out a 7-inch single, and it happens with me hardly paying attention. I guess it depended on how much I liked it or if I had anything to do with it. But there was a time when it was a big deal, when we would all anticipate the release of these records for months. We would wait impatiently to hear back from the mastering plant so we could finally hear the quality of the test pressing. The anticipation would build with each passing day, or the factory delivering the good news that our baby was on its way back into our hands and hopefully finding a new place in our hearts. It was exciting, these records that we all created. P.I. worked up these songs for months. We could write each song and learn how to play them the best we could. The band would then go into the studio to record. We'd spend days experimenting to make them sound the best we could, and then begin pasting the artwork together, taking photos, writing out the lyric sheet and the credits. We spent time thinking about the track listing. We wanted the songs to flow into each other, a smooth, seamless transition. I've always liked when the way one song's end leads into how the next song begins. To this day, that's how I make set lists. Making those records was fun, and what we got in return was rewarding, even if no one listened to it. We made it for ourselves, and we only had ourselves to blame if it was crap or we felt it didn't cut the mustard. When we made Feel the Darkness, we all agreed we had done a good job, but that record wasn't made in one recording session. That's worth noting. The reason it sounds all varied on that album is because we had 2 to 3 different lineups playing at different sessions. It was a Frankenstein of a record, with different parts from different people. A fistful of singles all heaped together and then a bunch of filler to round it out. It worked, but bringing the master tapes back into the studio years later to remix it, the engineer said that he could easily tell the different sessions apart. They were easy to separate. That's an engineer's ear for you. It sounds like one big wall of noise to me. Dim sum for dimwit. We already had the Sub Pop single, Taken by Surprise, and a cassette single, Plastic Bomb. We all wrote the rest of the songs to stuff it tight and make an album's worth of material. The title song, Feel the Darkness, was something I had been kicking around for a while. I wanted it to sound one way, and when we were done, it sounded completely different. Kind of like how Joy Division set out to sound like Iggy Pop, but wound up sounding nothing like him when they were done. The lyrics to that song came from a true story, like almost all of the songs on that record. Feel the Darkness was about a friend I had. She was a girl who got strung out, and to support her habit, she turned to prostitution. You put yourself in dangerous places all the time doing that. Out of desperation, you might make poor decisions you wouldn't in the cold light of day. Well, she cruised the wrong John. The guy turned out to be a serial killer who tortured and murdered a half dozen Portland prostitutes, society's throwaways, and she was one of them. This guy was known as the Molalla Forest Killer and is one of the most prolific serial killers in Oregon's history. I think he admitted to killing 8 and may be suspected of more. One sensationalistic and deeply disturbing detail the press picked up on was that he'd sometimes saw off the feet of his victims, maybe even when they were still alive. You can only hope there is a special place in hell beyond Dante's imaginings for this piece of scum. I was kind of traumatized by this girl's random, senseless death, so I put it to music and made up the song Feel the Darkness. Therapy, the only way I knew. In the documentary, Myrtle relates the story of getting an early morning call from Tom who said something like, "Fuck whatever you're doing. Jerry has this new song, Grab Your Bass, Pick Up Some Sake and a 40-ouncer and Take a Cab. We've got to get this down now. It cracks me up because Feel the Darkness wasn't a hard song to learn. Three chords and the truth, as the country musicians used to say. I think one thing that worked in our favor over the years was that I wrote a lot of the music and I wasn't that good of a musician. But the guys in the band were skilled and could take my songs to another level. Almost everyone we've ever had in PI was really talented, and some were even virtuosos. Alan's On Fire was about David Wilde's co-worker friend who lived with his nagging, abusive wife and some spoiled, unloving children. They henpecked, disrespected, and walked all over this poor guy so much he finally snapped. He called them over one Thanksgiving, and he walked into his backyard, poured a can of gasoline over his head, and set himself on fire in front of his family. You write about what you know, and these were our murder ballads set to the heavy hardcore music that we were playing. When we were touring the East Coast right before we recorded this album, I stayed in Astoria, Queens with my friends John and Yana from the band Big Stick. I barely remember anything about my stay in NYC because I was so blitzed, though I do remember John and Yana basically pouring me into a cab to get to a gig at the Pyramid Club or ABC No Rio. And hanging out with John and Yana led to the creation of a PI song. Big Stick was really into drag racing and stock cars, and they had a great single called Drag Racing, which is still one of my all-time favorite singles. John said that I should write an old-fashioned rock song about hot rods. I pictured in my head what that would sound like. All these songs that you write, I always thought they all have their own personality, and if I was going to write a song about cars, girls, rebellion, this is what it would sound like. It wrote itself. Fast drum intro, relentless guitar pounding, quick chord changes. A car flying down the road, throwing beer bottles out the window, then driving off of a cliff. We released that as a 7-inch picture disc single and then later added that and whatever else we had laying around, and that was our album. When we recorded that song, Just to Get Away, we were going through another lineup change. Coxman, Mondo, Veg, Tickner, and Aldine were all around the year before and during the recording, so everybody threw their communal hats into the communal stew. We had recruited Aldine from Salt Lake City. He had actually pitched a tent in Tom's backyard when he got to town. Mondo moved over to bass. Aldine was a good player. He was also a thin guy, so when we'd play live, I would lift him up high and sometimes flip him over so he could play upside down. It was a crowd pleaser. But when we were in the middle of recording the album, Aldine had a problem with priorities. Mark Pauline's performance art group Survival Research Laboratories was having a show in Seattle. Aldine wanted to go, and we insisted he stay to record. He wouldn't agree. He wanted to see this SRL performance, and we wanted him to stay and record. He left for Seattle, and we kicked him out. That's how we rolled. We figured if you weren't totally committed, we could find someone who wanted it badly enough that they would be 100% invested, though sometimes it wasn't even a band member's fault that they'd get kicked out of the band. One of the guitarists, after years of not having female companionship due to his being a nerdy heavy metal musician, found himself with his first girlfriend after he joined Poison Idea. Unfortunately, the girl was an ex-girlfriend of one of the original members, and we hadn't gotten along with her the first time around.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.